Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Immunity to Change, How to Overcome It and Unlock the Potential in Yourself and Your Organization by Robert Kegan and Lisa Laskow Lahey. Narrated by Stephen R. Thorne. Publisher's note: this audiobook is packaged with bonus material, which has been included on the first audio and MP3 CD. If you downloaded this audiobook in a digital format, please visit tantor.com and type Immunity to Change into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then click on PDF Extra 1. When prompted, enter the access code LEADERSHIP to access the bonus material. Preface. This book has literally taken us our whole professional lives to write. Advanced reviewers say you will find here an entirely novel but thoroughly road-tested approach to bringing about significant improvements in individuals and groups in the workplace. Well, it's true that our road is well-paved. The ideas and practices you will learn about here have been put to good use by a national railway in Europe, an international financial services company, one of America's most admired technology companies, the leadership of a statewide child welfare agency, superintendents and their principals in several U.S. school districts, senior partners in the world's leading international strategy consulting firm, and the fastest-growing labor union in America. But it has also been a winding road, and to tell the truth, we didn't set out originally to work on the problem we are now getting credit for solving: how to close the gap between what people genuinely intend to do and what they are actually able to bring about. 25 years ago, we would have been of little use to these organizations. Though we knew then we were on a trail worth a lifetime of exploration, we had no idea or plan that it would bring us to leaders and their teams in public and private sectors in the United States, Europe, Asia, and Africa. We began as academic psychologists researching the development of mindsets and mental complexity in adulthood, with one of us, Kegan, taking the lead in the development of a new theory, and the other, Lahey, taking the lead in developing the research method and assessment procedures to test and refine it. We proceeded in the 1980s to uncover something that has been fascinating us and fellow researchers and practitioners all over the world ever since. We discovered the possibility of life after adolescence. Despite the popular, and at that time even scientific, belief that our minds, like our bodies, don't get any taller after adolescence, we found that some of our adult research subjects were able to evolve whole patterns of increasingly complex and agile ways of apprehending the world. While few attained the most advanced growth patterns our investigations revealed, it was apparent through longitudinal research, carefully assessing and reassessing the same people over many years, that when people did evolve, it was always in the same sequence. Each new mental plateau gradually overcame the systematic limitations of the prior one. Further research eventually demonstrated that each qualitative leap forward enhances not only people's ability to see into themselves and their world, but to act more effectively as well. You will learn more about these mental plateaus in the first chapter of this book. But we also saw that many people did not evolve a whole new mental system after adolescence, and if they moved at all, it wasn't far. Since we have always been educators at heart and have spent our university lives not in a school of management but a school of education, we wanted to know whether one could do anything to support these shifts in the expansiveness and complexity of our mindsets. Were such advances just a matter of fate and random variation, completely out of our hands? Or could people actually be helped to grow? This took us further down our road throughout the 1990s and led us to a second discovery. We had been studying the evolution of mental development from the outside, as it were, seeking to describe the structure of each way of meaning-making, why it created the reality it did, what changed in a structure when it evolved. But now, without our quite realizing it, we were finding our way into the inner dynamics, in particular a sort of master motive that keeps us on our current plateau. We uncovered a phenomenon we call the immunity to change, a heretofore hidden dynamic that actively and brilliantly prevents us from changing because of its devotion to preserving our existing way of making meaning. We first introduced listeners to the concept of immunity to change in our 2001 book, How the Way We Talk Can Change the Way We Work. There, we presented a deceptively simple process, distilled and refined over many years, by which people can uncover the hidden motivations and beliefs that prevent them from making the very changes they know they should make and very much want to make, whether the goal is being more courageous in my communications or losing weight. The reception to that book has been enormously gratifying, as it has been to watch what happens when we personally guide people, now several thousand a year, through this process, as we will guide you, if you wish, in Chapter 9. They repeatedly say things like, "I never saw that coming," and "I got more out of that in 3 hours than 3 years in therapy." But the truth is, what people are raving about is the power and clarity of a new insight they are having, and the speed with which they get to it. And we all know there is a big gulf between insight and the ability to act upon it. We knew we had developed something powerful and practical, but we were still a long way from satisfying the listener's true goal, not just greater insight into why one person can't delegate or another can't deliver upward feedback, despite his firm resolve, but the ability to actually do it, and a long way from satisfying our own, being able not just to see the internal mechanisms that perpetuate a current mindset, but also to help someone transcend its limitations. Shortly after How the Way We Talk was published, we went before a group of chief knowledge officers and human resource heads from Fortune 500 companies and large international NGOs. They belonged to a consortium that previewed promising new ideas and practices still in the development stage and gave the inventors the frankest possible assessment of their value. We didn't talk to them about what we had found or invented. We simply asked them to try the process themselves for a few hours under our guidance. When they were done, they all said the same thing, but their reaction was best summed up by one CKO. "I've got good news and bad news. First, the good news. I've spent 20 years in the field of capability building and performance improvement, and what you have just done with us is the single most powerful piece of learning technology I've ever seen. It's like you've conceived the jet engine in the era of the prop plane, and you've demonstrated here you can get the thing off the ground. Now, the bad news. You haven't a clue what to do with the plane now that you've gotten it airborne, where to fly it, or how to land it." He was pretty much right. We have since learned from some listeners of How the Way We Talk that once given the boost to get airborne, they could fly their planes on their own to their desired destinations. But for most people, greater insight, however exhilarating, is insufficient to bring about lasting change. We still had a big piece of work ahead of us, a third threshold that needed crossing, and this one took yet another 7 or 8 years, the time between the publication of our last book and this one. One of the things we've had going for us in this last stretch has been our recognition that the goal of helping people to deliver on very specific improvements, changes that have proven resistant to thoughtful plans and heartfelt resolutions, is intimately related to the goal of helping people to develop a new meaning-making system that can transcend the limitations of their current one. Building on our colleague Ronald Heifetz's heuristic distinction between technical and adaptive challenges, we can say that some personal change goals, especially those we know we must accomplish but still cannot, require that we ourselves get bigger. That is, we must adapt in order to accomplish them. Thus, we suspected that if we could build a successful learning platform that moved from diagnosing immunities to overcoming them, we might deliver on both goals at the same time. We knew our diagnostic process helped make the invisible visible, which our research showed to be the driver of increasing mental complexity, moving mental structures from subject to object, from master to tool. The ability to enter and transform the mindset, we reasoned, should prove to be a crucial asset for meeting specific adaptive challenges. And conversely, the personal urgency to meet an adaptive challenge should make the challenge a kind of Trojan horse, a riveting object of attention that, once engaged, might break open and transform the whole mental field. Immunity to change presents the outcome of our pursuit of these hunches for the last several years. From our point of view, the best test of our learning platform asks more than, does it enable me to accomplish my specific improvement goal? For example, did I become a more courageous communicator? Am I now a better delegator? Certainly, it would be a valuable platform if the answer to this question, more often than not, were yes. But we began with a bigger aspiration that prompts an additional question. And does it also promote advances in mental complexity, the kind of change that will permit a whole range of new abilities, not just meeting the single initial improvement goal? If the answer to this were yes, then the payoffs for investing in an adaptive approach to personal improvement would be many, many times the value of accomplishing a single goal. It will be up to you, as you examine the cases and accounts in this book, to assess how strong our learning platform is. If you come to feel the answer to our second, tougher question is also yes, then a central message of this book, "People can change," should take on a double meaning for you. Yes, people, even adults, can make significant improvements in focused areas where they have many times before tried and failed. And yes, even grown-ups can continue to evolve more complex mental systems, analogous to the transformations from childhood to adolescence, enabling a more penetrating, more responsible, less egocentric grasp of reality. If you have no familiarity with our earlier books, welcome. We have no expectation that you do, and they are not a prerequisite for getting the most out of this one. If you have ever tried and failed to make changes in your own life or to help others make changes in theirs, read on. We wrote this book for you, especially if you lead, manage, supervise, consult, counsel, train, coach, or teach, and personal improvement or team performance at work is one of your biggest concerns. This book is for you. If you are familiar with our work, welcome back. Perhaps you read How the Way We Talk Can Change the Way We Work and wondered, now that you have uncovered the immunity to change and helped me see my problem, have you learned anything about how to help me solve this problem? We wrote this book for you also. If you have an interest in adult development, if you think about the possibility of significant forward leaps in psychological complexity after adolescence, if you have read Kegan's earlier books, The Evolving Self or In Over Our Heads, and you wonder if we have learned anything new about how better to support these leaps, then you too are our target audience. Finally, if you have known all along that our very practical work on immunities to change is founded on our theoretical and research work on the evolution of mindsets and meaning systems, and have been wondering when we would ever get around to explicitly bringing them together to shed new light on creating learning organizations or meeting adaptive challenges, then this book is for you as well. Introduction. No leader needs convincing that improvement and change is at the top of the agenda. And no leader needs a book of sympathy for how hard it is to bring change about, whether in oneself or in others. We all know that change is hard, but we don't know enough about why it is so hard and what we can do about it. Most of the favorite explanations, while true in some cases, turn out to be weak answers to why the changes that are called for today are so difficult. Lack of urgency, inadequate incentives, uncertainty about what we really need to do differently. Are these really the primary barriers to change you see in yourself and in those who work and live around you? Not long ago, a medical study showed that if heart doctors tell their seriously at-risk heart patients they will literally die if they do not make changes to their personal lives, diet, exercise, smoking, still only 1 in 7 is actually able to make the changes. 1 in 7. And we can safely assume that the other 6 wanted to live, see more sunsets, watch their grandchildren grow up. They didn't lack a sense of urgency. The incentives for change could not be greater. The doctors made sure they knew just what they needed to do. Still, they couldn't do it. If people cannot make the changes they dearly want to when their very lives are on the line, then how can leaders at any level in any kind of organization expect to successfully support processes of change, even those that they and their subordinates may passionately believe in, when the stakes and the payoff are not nearly as high? Could it be any clearer that we need some new ways of understanding what prevents and enables our own change? As with the heart patients, the change challenges today's leaders and their subordinates face are not, for the most part, a problem of will. The problem is the inability to close the gap between what we genuinely, even passionately, want and what we are actually able to do. Closing this gap is a central learning problem of the 21st century. 3 problems create the context for this book. This disjunction between our increased understanding of the need for change and our lack of understanding as to what prevents it is the first of 3 fertile problems that lay the foundation for this book. If you are like the leaders with whom we have been working over many years while developing these ideas and practices, you may be a little skeptical about how much anyone, yourself included, really can change. This brings us to a second fertile problem. Every year, in response to increasing challenges and opportunities, organizations across all sectors collectively invest precious resources, billions of dollars, and extraordinary amounts of time trying to improve their people's capabilities. Anyone might be forgiven for imagining that the endless parade of professional development programs, personal improvement plans, leadership trainings, performance reviews, and executive coaching reflects a deep-seated optimism among leaders about the prospects for personal change. Why else would they make such investments? And yet, whenever we win the confidence and friendship of leaders, we are likely to hear, often over drinks or a good meal, "Let's face it, people don't really change much. I mean, at the end of the day, Al is always going to be Al. By the time someone is 30 or 35, he is who he is. I suppose you can hope for little adjustments around the margins, but really I think the best you can do is leverage the hell out of the guy's strengths and hire around his weaknesses. Why wear yourself out and beat the poor guy up for changes he isn't going to make?" Thus, the interesting truth is that riding alongside the public optimism reflected in enormous organizational investments in people development is a deep-seated private pessimism about how much people really can change. And we come by this pessimism honestly. On more than one occasion, in more than one country, working in more than one sector, we have heard essentially this same story. We take the year-end reviews very seriously around here. It's not like the Dilbert cartoons where people roll their eyes as they enter the room and wait for the psychobabble and pep talk to be over. People listen carefully to the feedback they get. A lot of company time and money goes into its gathering and debriefing, and a lot of heart and mind goes into attending to it on the receiving end. People sometimes cry in these meetings. They make the sincerest of pledges and the most careful of plans to change the things that need to be changed. Everyone leaves the room feeling like an intense and real conversation has occurred and the time was well spent. And then, a year later, we are all back in the room looking at the feedback, and the picture really isn't that different. Something is wrong here. It sure is, and that's why we wrote this book. We have a resounding answer to the debate about whether people and organizational culture really can change. The changes you are going to read about here are not little adjustments around the margins, and their proof does not rest on the self-deception of self-evaluation. It comes from evaluations, often anonymous evaluations, by one's toughest critics, the people who live with you every day at work and at home. When clients, coworkers, or family members respond to our surveys by saying, "Whatever you're doing with Nicholas, can you do it with his partners too?" from a client. Our whole team senses an enormous shift in Martin. He has become a pleasure to work with. The team is much more productive. I would never have predicted this. From a coworker. I've had the first real conversation with Mom I've had in years. From a family member. Then we start to believe something of importance is really happening. The evidence comes, too, in experiences like the recent one we had working with the leadership of a school district thousands of miles from our home. We have been working with them for a few years now, and since they are so far away, we have been building up a local crew of change coaches to carry on the work. We had arranged for a promising new candidate to visit the offsite we were conducting. She was a highly experienced school professional, and we invited her to just sit in and observe, to get a feel for the kind of work these administrators were undertaking with us. We were mostly absorbed in the work we were doing, but every time we looked at our visitor, we couldn't help but notice what seemed to us a disturbed look on her face. About 2 hours into her visit, we saw her get up and, without warning, walk out of the room with a slack-jawed expression of shock. She never returned. I guess that didn't go too well, one of us remembers thinking. A few days later, we checked in with one of our team members who had caught up with her. She had been shocked, all right. "I've spent my whole life working with school leaders," she said. "I've never heard conversation of that sort. I've never heard people be as honest or as responsible. I've never heard people talking about things that are more likely to lead to real change." Before you get too far into this book, you'll get a full picture of what this kind of conversation looks like. She left because she had another appointment. She wanted to know how she could join the coaching team. The materials in the pages ahead suggest a next generation of ideas and practices for leaders with an interest in the learning life of their organizations. It has been nearly 20 years since Peter Senge's fifth discipline first inspired leaders to think about learning organizations, and more than 25 years since Donald Schoen's The Reflective Practitioner rekindled the importance of attending, literally, to the mind at work. All over the world today, in every sector, leaders aspire to lead organizations that learn and to be themselves personally reflective about what they do. But we need to take individual and collective learning at work to the next level if we are to meet 21st century change challenges. If we do not, we can learn and reflect as much as we want, but the changes we hope for or that others need from us will not happen because all the learning and reflecting will occur within our existing mindsets. This brings us to our third and last fertile problem. Our MIT colleagues, Senge and Schoen, inspired many leaders at the end of the last century to incorporate a responsibility for learning into their short list of leadership priorities. The theory base and set of practices associated with the concept of the learning organization is a rich and growing one, but it has always had a missing dimension that might be most noticeable to people like us who have spent their lives in the field of education. It lacks a sophisticated understanding of adult development. When Senge and Schoen wrote their books, the brain scientists were still insisting there were no qualitative changes in our mental equipment after adolescence. Meanwhile, like other soft scientists, we were conducting our own research, which we came to feel suggested a quite different picture. Today, the hard and soft scientists agree that the story of mental development does not need to end in adolescence, but we have yet to catch up to the implications of this dramatic revision of our possibilities. This lack of an adult developmental dimension in organizational learning theory has never been more important than the present, as leaders increasingly ask people to do things they are not now able to do, were never prepared to do, and are not yet developmentally well matched to do. The field of leadership development has over-attended to leadership and under-attended to development. An endless stream of books tries to identify the most important elements of leadership and help leaders to acquire these abilities. Meanwhile, we ignore the most powerful source of ability, our capacity, and the capacity of the people who work for us, to overcome at any age the limitations and blind spots of current ways of making meaning. Without a better understanding of human development, what it is, how it is enabled, how it is constrained, what passes for leadership development will more likely amount to leadership learning or leadership training. The knowledge and skills gained will be like new files and programs brought to the existing operating system. They may have a certain value. New files and programs do give you greater range and versatility, but your ability to use them will still be limited by your current operating system. True development is about transforming the operating system itself, not just increasing your fund of knowledge or your behavioral repertoire. If you are leading anything at any level, you are driving some kind of plan or agenda. But some kind of plan or agenda is also driving you. It is out of your awareness. You cannot yet take responsibility for it, and most of the time, that agenda will limit or even doom your ability to deliver extraordinary results. If you do not attend as much to development as to leadership, then your leadership development will always be directed to the plan or agenda you have. It will not be about the plan or agenda that has you, and therefore, your capacity for change will inherently be limited. The accounts and stories you will find here suggest a route to genuine development, to the qualitative expansions of mind that significantly increase human capability at work, not by rehiring, but by renewing existing talent. The plan of this book. This book is divided into three parts. The first part provides a new way to understand change. The second shows you the value of our approach for individuals, work teams, and entire organizations. The third part invites you to try the approach for yourself. Part 1 begins with a quick tutorial on what we have learned from 30 years of research on the development of mental complexity in adulthood and its meaning for work life. Chapter 1 provides the theoretical and empirical foundations for all the accounts and practices that follow. In Chapter 2, we introduce our discovery of a previously hidden phenomenon that prevents us from making the very changes we passionately intend, the dynamic we call the immunity to change. In Chapter 3, you will learn from two leaders, one from business and one from government, how and why they brought this work into their organizations and the benefits they saw happening as a result. In Part 2, we provide extended accounts of the kinds of changes we have seen organizations and individuals make when they identify and work through their immunities to change. We choose people from a variety of sectors, working on the full range of improvement goals we typically encounter. In Chapter 4, we explore what happens when groups assess their collective immunity to change. In Chapters 5 and 6, we follow two individuals addressing their personal immunity to change, and in Chapter 7, we show the most ambitious design, team members working to overcome their individual immunities in the context of an intact, ongoing work group seeking to improve its collective performance. In Part 3, we invite you into a direct experience of the phenomenon at the heart of this book, guiding you through your own individual and collective immunity to change journey. Chapter 8 identifies the ingredients needed to support this kind of change process. In Chapters 9 and 10, we take you through a step-by-step process to diagnosis and then to go to work on overcoming your individual immunity to change. Chapter 11 gives you the tools and process to help you bring the immunity work to your team or organization. In the conclusion, we discuss the 7 attributes of leaders who work successfully to make their settings a consistently fertile place for the growth of personal and collective capability. We doubt you'd be listening to this book unless some part of you already knows how important it is for people to significantly enhance what they can do at work, hopes there is a new reason to believe in this possibility, and wonders what you might do to help bring it about. We hope you find the book good company on all these fronts, a resource for your head, heart, gut, and hand, and that it helps you achieve the results you want. Part 1. Uncovering a hidden dynamic in the challenge of change. 1. Reconceiving the challenge of change. What will distinguish your leadership from others in the years ahead? As the subtitle of this book suggests, we believe it will be your ability to develop yourself, your people, and your teams. Throughout the world, and this is as true in the United States and Europe as it is in China and India, human capability will be the critical variable in the new century. But leaders who seek to win a war for talent by conceiving of capability as a fixed resource to be found out there put themselves and their organizations at a serious disadvantage. In contrast, leaders who ask themselves, "What can I do to make my setting the most fertile ground in the world for the growth of talent?" put themselves in the best position to succeed. These leaders understand that for each of us to deliver on our biggest aspirations, to take advantage of new opportunities or to meet new challenges, we must grow into our future possibilities. These leaders know what makes that more possible and what prevents it. The challenge to change and improve is often misunderstood as a need to better deal with or cope with the greater complexity of the world. Coping and dealing involve adding new skills or widening our repertoire of responses. We are the same person we were before we learned to cope. We have simply added some new resources. We have learned, but we have not necessarily developed. Coping and dealing are valuable skills, but they are actually insufficient for meeting today's change challenges. In reality, the experience of complexity is not just a story about the world. It is also a story about people. It is a story about the fit between the demands of the world and the capacity of the person or the organization. When we experience the world as too complex, we are not just experiencing the complexity of the world. We are experiencing a mismatch between the world's complexity and our own at this moment. There are only two logical ways to mend this mismatch: reduce the world's complexity or increase our own. The first isn't going to happen. The second has long seemed an impossibility in adulthood. We, the authors of this book, have spent a generation now studying the growth of mental complexity in adulthood. We think what we have learned may help you to better understand yourself and those who work with you and for you. In gaining that awareness, you will begin to see a new frontier of human capabilities, the place where tomorrow's most successful leaders will focus their leadership attention. An updated view of age and mental complexity. The ideas and practices you will find in this book begin by identifying a widespread misconception about the potential trajectory of mental development across the lifespan. When we began our work, the accepted picture of mental development was akin to the picture of physical development. Your growth was thought fundamentally to end by your 20s. If, 30 years ago, you were to place age on one axis and mental complexity on another, and you asked the experts in the field to draw the graph as they understood it, they would have produced something similar to figure 1-1 in the bonus PDF, an upward sloping line until the 20s, and a flat line thereafter. And they would have drawn it with confidence. When we began reporting the results of our research in the 1980s, suggesting that some, though not all, adults seemed to undergo qualitative advances in their mental complexity akin to earlier, well-documented quantum leaps from early childhood to later childhood and from later childhood to adolescence, our brain researcher colleagues sitting next to us on distinguished panels would smile with polite disdain. "You might think you can infer this from your longitudinal interviews," they would say, "but hard science doesn't have to make inferences. We're looking at the real thing. The brain simply doesn't undergo any significant change in capacity after late adolescence. Sorry." Of course, these hard scientists would grant that older people are often wiser or more capable than younger people, but this they attributed to the benefits of experience, a consequence of learning how to get more out of the same mental equipment rather than any qualitative advances or upgrades to the equipment itself. 30 years later? Whoops. It turns out everybody was making inferences, even the brain scientists who thought they were looking at the thing itself. The hard scientists have better instruments today, and the brain doesn't look to them the way it did 30 years ago. Today, they talk about neuroplasticity and the phenomenal capacities of the brain to keep adapting throughout life. If we were to draw the graph showing age and mental complexity today, on the basis of 30 years of longitudinal research by our colleagues and us, as a result of thoroughly analyzing the transcripts of hundreds of people interviewed and re-interviewed at several year intervals, the graph would look like figure 1-2 in the bonus PDF. Two things are evident. With a large enough sample size, you can detect a mildly upward sloping curve. That is, looking at a population as a whole, mental complexity tends to increase with age throughout adulthood, at least until old age, so the story of mental complexity is certainly not a story that ends in our 20s. There is considerable variation within any age. For example, six people in their 30s, the bolded dots, could all be at different places in their level of mental complexity, and some could be more complex than a person in her 40s. If we were to draw a quick picture of what we have learned about the individual trajectory of mental development in adulthood, it might look something like figure 1-3 in the bonus PDF. This picture suggests several different elements. There are qualitatively different, discernibly distinct levels, the plateaus. That is, the demarcations between levels of mental complexity are not arbitrary. Each level represents a quite different way of knowing the world. Development does not unfold continuously. There are periods of stability and periods of change. When a new plateau is reached, we tend to stay on that level for a considerable period of time, although elaborations and extensions within each system can certainly occur. The intervals between transformations to new levels, time on a plateau, get longer and longer. The line gets thinner, representing fewer and fewer people at the higher plateaus. But what do these different levels of mental complexity in adulthood actually look like? Can we say something about what a more complex level can see or do that a less complex level cannot? Indeed, we can now say a great deal about these levels. Mental complexity and its evolution is not about how smart you are in the ordinary sense of the word. It is not about how high your IQ is. It is not about developing more and more abstract, abstruse apprehensions of the world, as if most complex means finally being able to understand a physicist's blackboard filled with complex equations. Three plateaus in adult mental complexity. Later on in this book, we will say more about these levels, but for now, let's begin with a quick overview of three qualitatively different plateaus in mental complexity we see among adults, as suggested in figures 1-4 and 1-5 in the bonus PDF. These three adult meaning systems, the socialized mind, the self-authoring mind, and self-transforming mind, make sense of the world and operate within it in profoundly different ways. We can determine how this shows up at work by focusing on any significant aspect of organizational life and seeing how the very same phenomenon, for example, information flow, is completely different through the lens of each perspective. The way information does or does not flow through an organization, what people send, to whom they send it, how they receive or attend to what flows to them, is an obviously crucial feature of how any system works. Experts on organizational culture, organizational behavior, or organizational change often address this subject with a sophisticated sense of how systems impact individual behavior, but with an astonishingly naive sense of how powerful a factor is the level of mental complexity with which the individual views that organizational culture or change initiative. Socialized mind. Having a socialized mind dramatically influences both the sending and receiving aspects of information flow at work. If this is the level of mental complexity with which I view the world, then what I think to send will be strongly influenced by what I believe others want to hear. You may be familiar with the classic group think studies, which show team members withholding crucial information from collective decision processes because, it is later learned in follow-up research, although I knew the plan had almost no chance of succeeding, I saw that the leader wanted our support. Some of these group think studies were originally done in Asian cultures, where withholding team members talked about saving face of leaders and not subjecting them to shame, even at the price of setting the company on a losing path. The studies were often presented as if they were uncovering a particularly cultural phenomenon. Similarly, Stanley Milgram's famous obedience to authority research was originally undertaken to fathom the mentality of the good German, and what about the German culture could enable otherwise decent, non-sadistic people to carry out orders to exterminate millions of Jews and Poles. But Milgram, in practice runs of his data-gathering method, was surprised to find good Germans all over Main Street, USA. And although we think of sensitivity to shame as a particular feature of Asian culture, the research of Irving Janis and Paul Attard has made clear that groupthink is as robust a phenomenon in Texas and Toronto as it is in Tokyo and Taiwan. It is a phenomenon that owes its origin not to culture, but to complexity of mind. The socialized mind also strongly influences how information is received and attended to. When maintaining alignment with important others and valued surrounds is crucial to the coherence of one's very being, the socialized mind is highly sensitive to and influenced by what it picks up. And what it picks up often runs far beyond the explicit message. It may well include the results of highly invested attention to imagined subtexts that may have more impact on the receiver than the intended message. This is often astonishing and dismaying to leaders who cannot understand how subordinates could possibly have made that sense out of this communication. But because the receiver's signal-to-noise detector may be highly distorted, the actual information that comes through may have only a distant relationship to the sender's intention. Self-authoring mind. Let's contrast all this with the self-authoring mind. If I view the world from this level of mental complexity, what I send is more likely to be a function of what I deem others need to hear to best further the agenda or mission of my design. Consciously or unconsciously, I have a direction, an agenda, a stance, a strategy, an analysis of what is needed, a prior context from which my communication arises. My direction or plan may be an excellent one, or it may be riddled with blind spots. I may be masterful or inept at recruiting others to invest themselves in this direction. These matters implicate other aspects of the self. But mental complexity strongly influences whether my information sending is oriented toward getting behind the wheel in order to drive, the self-authoring mind, or getting myself included in the car so I can be driven, the socialized mind. We can see a similar mindset operating when receiving as well. The self-authoring mind creates a filter for what it will allow to come through. It places a priority on receiving the information it has sought. Next in importance is information whose relevance to my plan, stance, or frame is immediately clear. Information I haven't asked for, and which does not have obvious relevance to my own design for action, has a much tougher time making it through my filter. It is easy to see how all of this could describe an admirable capacity for focus, for distinguishing the important from the urgent, for making best use of one's limited time by having a means to cut through the unending and ever-mounting claims on one's attention. This speaks to the way the self-authoring mind is an advance over the socialized mind. But this same description may also be a recipe for disaster if one's plan or stance is flawed in some way. If it leaves out some crucial element of the equation not appreciated by the filter, or if the world changes in such a way that a once good frame becomes an antiquated one. Self-transforming mind. In contrast, the self-transforming mind also has a filter, but is not fused with it. The self-transforming mind can stand back from its own filter and look at it, not just through it. And why would it do so? Because the self-transforming mind both values and is wary about any one stance, analysis, or agenda. It is mindful that, powerful though a given design might be, this design almost inevitably leaves something out. It is aware that it lives in time and that the world is in motion, and what might have made sense today may not make as much sense tomorrow. Therefore, when communicating, people with self-transforming minds are not only advancing their agenda and design, they are also making space for the modification or expansion of their agenda or design. Like those with self-authoring minds, what they send may include inquiries and requests for information. But rather than inquiring only within the frame of their design, seeking information that will advance their agenda, they are also inquiring about the design itself. They are seeking information that may lead them or their team to enhance, refine, or alter the original design, or make it more inclusive. Information sending is not just on behalf of driving. It is also to remake the map, or reset the direction. Similarly, the way the self-transforming mind receives information includes the advantages of the self-authoring mind's filter, but is not a prisoner of that filter. People at this level of mental complexity can still focus, select, and drive when they feel they have a good map, but they place a higher priority on information that may also alert them to the limits of their current design or frame. They value their filter and its ability to separate the wheat from the chaff, but they know it can also screen out the golden chaff, the unasked for, the anomaly, the apparently inconsequential that may be just what is needed to turn the design on its head and bring it to the next level of quality. Those with self-transforming minds are more likely to have the chance even to consider such information because people are more likely to send it to them. Why is this? Because those with self-transforming minds not only attend to information once it gets to their door, they also realize their behavior can have a big effect, upstream, on whether people decide to approach the door. Others are not left guessing whether to send potentially off-mission communication they judge to be important. They send it because people with self-transforming minds have found ways to let them know such information will be welcomed. Mental complexity and performance. These descriptions, focusing on just a single important element of organizational life, information flow, should begin to make the different levels of mental complexity a little clearer. They also suggest a value proposition for mental complexity. Each successive level of mental complexity is formally higher than the preceding one because it can perform the mental functions of the prior level as well as additional functions. But the discussion of how information flow is conceived and handled also suggests that these formal mental properties translate into real actions with real consequences for organizational behavior and work competence. The implication is that a higher level of mental complexity outperforms a lower level. Is this just a hypothesis, albeit with some plausible face validity, or has it actually been tested and systematically demonstrated? There are now a number of studies correlating measures of mental complexity with independent assessments of work competence or performance. We will consider these results in greater depth later in this book, but for now, let's just take a peek at what these studies show. Keith Eigel assessed the level of mental complexity of 21 CEOs of large, successful companies, each company an industry leader with average gross revenue of over $5 billion. He used a 90-minute interview assessment measure that we and our colleagues developed. The subject-object interview, described in How Do We Assess Level of Mental Complexity, has been used all over the world, across all sectors, over the last 20 years. It discriminates developmental movement between and within the levels of mental complexity with high degrees of inter-rater reliability. Using separate performance assessments, Eigel also evaluated the CEO's effectiveness in terms of the ability to challenge existing processes, inspire a shared vision, manage conflict, solve problems, delegate, empower, build relationships. In addition, for comparison, Igel did similar assessments in each of the same companies, interviewing promising middle managers nominated by their respective CEOs. Figure 1-6 in the bonus PDF summarizes his findings. Several results stand out. The first obvious one is the clearly discernible upward slope, signifying that increased mental complexity and work competence, assessed on a number of dimensions, are correlated. So not only is it possible to reach higher planes of mental complexity, but such growth correlates with effectiveness for both CEOs and middle managers. This finding has been replicated in a variety of fine-grained studies of small numbers of leaders, assessed on particular competencies. Taken together, the cumulative data speaks anew to the problem of complexity. We begin to see how being at a given level of mental complexity can make a complex world more or less manageable. How do we assess level of mental complexity? Our assessment tool is a 90-minute interview we call the subject-object interview, so named because the complexity of a mindset is a function of the way it distinguishes the thoughts and feelings we have, for example, can look at, can take as object, from the thoughts and feelings that have us, for example, we are run by them, are subject to them. Each different level of mindset complexity differently draws the line between what is subject and what is object. Greater complexity means being able to look at more, take more as object. The blind spot, what is subject, becomes smaller and smaller. The assessment instrument has proven to be quite subtle. It can identify, with high degrees of inter-rater reliability, fully 5 different transitional places between any 2 mindsets. The interview begins by handing the subject 10 index cards, upon which are written the following cues: angry, anxious, nervous, success, strong stand, conviction, sad, torn, moved, touched, lost something, farewells, change, important. In the first 15 minutes, we ask the interviewee to make notes on each card in response to questions of the following form. Think of sometimes over the last few days or weeks when you found yourself feeling really mad or angry about something, or nervous, scared, anxious, etc., and jot down what comes to mind. The interview then proceeds as a systematic exploration. The interviewee tells us the what's, what made him feel angry, successful, etc., and we probe to learn the whys. Why would that make him feel angry or successful? Just what is at stake? We choose these prompts because earlier research showed them to be highly successful at eliciting the boundaries and contours of people's current way of constructing reality. A trained interviewer can probe such material to learn the underlying principle governing what the person can and cannot see, the blind spot. The interviews are transcribed and analyzed according to a uniform process. Thousands of these interviews have now been conducted with people all over the world, with people of all ages and from all walks of life. Most people find the interview a highly engaging experience. Shifts in the demands on followers and leaders. We can also take a more sweeping view of the same issue by considering the new demands on leaders and their subordinates in the faster, flatter, more interconnected world in which we live. Now let's consider what was asked, and is now asked, of subordinates. In the world in which we used to live, it was enough in most cases if people were good team players, pulled their weight, were loyal to the company or organization where they worked, and could be counted on to follow conscientiously the directions and signals of their boss. In other words, the socialized mind would be perfectly adequate to handle the nature of yesterday's demands upon subordinates. And today? Nathaniel Brandon writes, "In the past 2 or 3 decades, extraordinary developments have occurred in the American and global economies. The United States has shifted from a manufacturing society to an information society. We have witnessed the transition from physical labor to mind work as the dominant employee activity. We now live in a global economy characterized by rapid change, accelerating scientific and technological breakthroughs, and an unprecedented level of competitiveness. These developments create demand for higher levels of education and training than were required of previous generations. Everyone acquainted with business culture knows this. What is not understood is that these developments also create new demands on our psychological resources. Specifically, these developments ask for a greater capacity for innovation, self-management, personal responsibility, and self-direction. This is not just asked at the top, it is asked at every level of a business enterprise, from senior management to first-line supervisors, and even to entry-level personnel. Today, organizations need not only an unprecedentedly higher level of knowledge and skill among all those who participate, but also a higher level of independence, self-reliance, self-trust, and the capacity to exercise initiative. What is Brandon, and many others who write about what we are now looking for from our workforce, really saying as it relates to level of mental complexity? He is saying, without realizing it, that it used to be sufficient for workers to be at the level of the socialized mind. But today, we need workers who are at the level of the self-authoring mind. In effect, we are calling upon workers to understand themselves and their world at a qualitatively higher level of mental complexity. And what is the picture if we look not at subordinates, but at bosses and leaders? Organizational theorist Chris Arjuris raises similar issues about the ever-growing insufficiency of traditional conceptions of managerial and leadership effectiveness that still dominate our thinking today. There may have been a day when it was enough for leaders to develop worthy goals and sensible norms, cultivate alignments around them, and work to keep organizational performance within the range specified, all the while exercising the strength of character to advocate for one's position and hold one's ground in the face of opposition. Skillful as such managers may be, their abilities will no longer suffice in a world that calls for leaders who can not only run, but reconstitute their organizations, its norms, missions, and culture, in an increasingly fast-changing environment. For example, a company that chooses to transform itself from a low-cost, standardized products organization to a mass customizer or a provider of organization-wide solutions will need to develop a whole new set of individual and team capabilities. Arjuris and Schoen describe the challenges of a similar organizational transition 30 years ago. This, in turn, requires that members of the corporation adopt new approaches to marketing, managing, and advertising, that they become accustomed to a much shorter product life cycle, and to a more rapid cycle of changes in their pattern of activities, that they, in fact, change the very image of the business they are in. And these requirements for change come into conflict with another sort of corporate norm, one that requires predictability in the management of corporate affairs. A process of change initiated with an eye to effectiveness under existing norms turns out to yield a conflict in the norms themselves. For more than a generation, Arjuris and those who have been influenced by him has unwittingly been calling for a new capacity of mind. This new mind would have the ability not just to author a view of how the organization should run and have the courage to hold steadfastly to that view. It would also be able to step outside of its own ideology or framework, observe the framework's limitations or defects, and reauthor a more comprehensive view, which it will hold with sufficient tentativeness that its limitations can be discovered as well. In other words, the kind of learner Arjuris rightly looks for in the leader of today may need to be a person who is making meaning with a self-transforming mind. Thus, we are asking more and more workers who could once perform their work successfully with socialized minds, good soldiers, to shift to self-authoring minds. And we are asking more and more leaders who could once lead successfully with self-authoring minds, sure and certain captains, to develop self-transforming minds. In short, we are asking for a quantum shift in individual mental complexity across the board. So how big is the gap between what we now expect of people's minds and what their minds are actually like? Are we expecting something that is so big a reach? After all, if the world has gotten more complex over the last half century, then perhaps the world has become a better incubator of mental complexity as well, and the supply of mental complexity has risen with the demand. We now have two sophisticated, reliable, and widely used measures for assessing mental complexity along the lines we are talking about here. This is something quite different, obviously, from IQ testing, which has only the most modest correlation with mental complexity. You can have an above-average IQ, say 125, and be at any of the three plateaus. These are the Washington University Sentence Completion Test, SCT, and the Subject-Object Interview, SOI, we introduced earlier. Two large meta-analyses of studies using one or the other of these measures have now been performed, with several hundred participants in each study. Figure 1-7, found in the bonus PDF, presents a quick summary of results. Two observations stand out from the data in Figure 1-7. Both studies, each done with completely different samples, arrive at the same finding, that in a majority of respondents, mental complexity is not as far along as the self-authoring mind. In fact, in each study, exactly 58% are not at this level. And since both studies are skewed toward middle-class, college-educated professionals, the actual percentage in the general population is likely even higher. The percentages of people beyond the plateau of the self-authoring mind are quite small. These data suggest that the gap between what we now expect of people's minds, including our own minds, and what our minds are actually like, is quite large. We expect most workers to be self-authoring, but most are not. We expect most leaders to be more complex than self-authoring, and very few are. We can see these same macro trends confirmed at the micro level if we return for a moment to the Eigel study. Note here that only about half of the promising middle managers are self-authoring, and those who are do better than those who are not. And only 4 of the 21 CEOs from industry-leading companies are beyond self-authoring, and those who are do better than those who are not. Mental complexity and technical versus adaptive challenges. Our colleague and friend Ronald Heifetz makes an important distinction that helps us summarize the central points we have made so far. Heifetz distinguishes between two kinds of change challenges, those he calls technical and others he calls adaptive. Technical changes are not necessarily easy, nor are their results necessarily unimportant or insignificant. Learning how to remove an inflamed appendix or how to land an airplane with a stuck nose wheel are examples of largely technical challenges, and their accomplishment is certainly important to the patient on the surgeon's table or the nervous passengers contemplating a crash landing. They are nonetheless technical from Heifetz's point of view because the skill set necessary to perform these complicated behaviors is well known. The routines and processes by which we might help an intern or novice pilot become an accomplished practitioner are well practiced and proven. While it is entirely possible that an intern or a pilot in training will become qualitatively more complex over years of training, such mental growth is beyond the scope of their technical training. Novice surgeons, for example, become sufficiently skilled surgeons without anyone worrying about their adult development or mental growth. However, many, if not most, of the change challenges you face today and will face tomorrow require something more than incorporating new technical skills into your current mindset. These are the adaptive challenges, and they can only be met by transforming your mindset, by advancing to a more sophisticated stage of mental development. Heifetz says the biggest error leaders make is when they apply technical means to solve adaptive challenges. In other words, we may be unable to bring about the changes we want because we are misdiagnosing our aspiration as technical, when in reality it is an adaptive challenge. The implication is that we must find adaptive, non-technical means of supporting ourselves and others to meet adaptive challenges. Distinguishing adaptive challenges from technical ones again brings our attention back from the problem to the person having the problem. We've said that complexity is really a story about the relationship between the complex demands and arrangements of the world and our own complexity of mind. When
we
look at this
relationship, we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.